All right, welcome back everyone. Shall we get started? So we discussed about praying a believing prayer and the importance of knowing God's will. Right now we're talking about faith associated with our prayer. There has got to be faith. We must believe whatever we are praying for. Now, another point for us to remember is, when we have faith, what is faith? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So, substance and evidence of something in our spirit. When we are asking God for a natural result, let's say for example, simple example, I'm a musician and I need a guitar. Okay. So my prayer request is, I want a guitar. And I know it's God's will. I need one in order to be able to equip myself. So I'm clear it's God's will and everything. I'm asking the Father in Jesus' name. And I have a clear conscience. I really want a guitar. I badly want a guitar. So there's a strong desire associated with it. Now, coming to faith, I am asking with faith in my heart. When you ask, believing that you receive. If you believe, you will receive, it says. So, when I pray for something, I must believe. Can we read Mark 11:24 one more time, please? I think Jiru read it. Jiru, can you read it again?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them.
Okay. So, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and then you will have them. So, when I pray, I must believe. Now, I've asked for a guitar.
Amen. Padpeva.
Okay, sorry, I didn't understand that, but anyway, we have muted. All right, so one must believe that they receive it and they will have it. Now, God has heard my prayer and the guitar is coming. Okay, when the guitar is coming, I don't know, but the guitar is coming. But what does Mark 11:24 say? You believe that you have received it. But guitar is still not there. Then, like, how to pray now? You believe that you have received it. Isn't that what it says? Verse 24, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Believe that you receive them. So, I receive. I believe that I am receiving the guitar. Then you will have them. So there is this other aspect of having the substance, the evidence of the things that we hope for, the things that are unseen. Right now, guitar is unseen. But my prayer is effective when I believe that I receive what I have asked for. So I've got asked God for a guitar. In my spirit, I am convinced. In other words, I didn't receive it in the natural, but in the spiritual, I've already received it. Are you all getting what I'm trying to say? Yeah? So even before the answer is there in the natural, you and I can have it in the spiritual. That's what faith is. So in the spiritual realm, the title deed, remember? We said title deed. You don't have the entire property yet, but you have the letter that says it is yours. So we must practice this. Believe that you receive them, then you will have them. So in the spiritual realm, you and I need an assurance in the spirit that we now have what we have prayed for. And that's important. That's when we will receive it. So now in my spirit, I've already received the assurance of that guitar. It may take a day, 2 days, 2 weeks, 2 months, 2 years. Hopefully not 2 years, but it will come. Because God has already given me peace in my spirit. It's coming. You know, it's like Abraham, the father of our faith. God told him, you will have a son, Isaac. And we read in Romans 4 that he continued with thanksgiving because he came to a place in his spirit. Isaac is not there in the natural, but in the spiritual, in his heart, by faith. He already knew. Yeah, it's done. Isaac will come. I'm convinced. I have faith. Okay, so that is what faith is all about. We can have faith now, even if we don't see the manifestation in the natural. Okay, so that is how a believing prayer should be, where I'm convinced. Now, is it possible that we pray a believing prayer and immediately we have faith for the answer? Now, in some situations, it can be that easy and that simple. But in some situations, it can take a long time for us to come to the place of faith. Okay? Long time with many struggles. We may have to engage with God, engage in prayer, fasting, reading the word, go meet an elder in church, ask their opinion. So much is happening for us to come to the place of faith. In order to believe when we pray and say, okay, God, I'm asking you in faith, and at this point, I am convinced that you're going to do it for me. So, arriving at the place of faith may be easy. It need not be easy also. It may take a while before we come to this place, but we have to come to this place if we want to receive from the Lord. All right? So, we've got to have faith. When we believe and we ask, that's when we are going to receive from the Lord. And when we are having faith in God, we'll see that faith is not passive. That means that, okay, I believe that God is going to do this. Okay, let's take, for example, the guitar. I'm a musician and the guitar will come. I am convinced. What to do in the meantime? Yeah, keep thanking God. Pray what? Yeah, thanksgiving. I'm no longer saying give, because I'm already convinced. I'm in a place of faith. So, okay, start preparing a room for that. I don't think it'll take a room. Just give us space. Okay. So you're working towards it, right? You're working towards owning the guitar and playing the guitar. So maybe, you attend some classes or you look up something on the internet. So the point is, we should not be just sitting and saying, Isaac is coming. Isaac is coming. Okay. I don't have to do anything. Be active in doing what God wants you to do while you're waiting for Isaac. Be active in what God wants you to do while you're waiting for the answer to your prayer, the guitar or whatever else it is. Okay? So, God wants us to move forward. Faith is always coupled with action. And faith is also coupled with declaration. Now, we do that in church every Sunday. We say, speak your faith. If you believe, speak it with your heart. Affirm with your mouth that, I am a child of God. I am blessed. I am victorious. Why are we doing that? Because the Bible teaches us, Mark 11:23, if you have faith in your heart, you will say to the mountain, So faith plus action, faith plus declaration. So if I have faith, I will have action and I will also have declaration. Both are necessary. So that's how it's going to work. Now in the spiritual, I already received answer to my prayer. It's just a matter of waiting for the manifestation. But while I am waiting, it's not passive. I am active and I am also speaking and declaring what God is going to do in my life. So that's the way to engage in a believing prayer and to believe that God is going to grant the request. So faith says, I already received it. All right. Now, what should we do if there is a time period before we get the answer? We said in the spirit, I already got the answer. But in the natural, what if it takes time? 2 years, 3 years. Yeah, don't lose hope. And how to continue now? Because it's going to take a long time before the answer comes. Okay, not to give up. Can I still pray? Yeah, how to pray? What to pray? Huh? Okay. So sort of preparatory prayers where you're saying, Lord, when I have it, then prepare me for that. Let me use it wisely. Equip me. Yeah, good prayers. We can pray that prayer. Any other prayers we can pray?
We can pray the prayer of thanksgiving. Lord, you already blessed me with that. So I'll give thanks to you.
Yeah, sure. So prayer of thanksgiving, because we believe it in our spirit that we've received it. So prayer of thanksgiving is another prayer which we can pray. What else should we pray? Okay. Ask for patience. Yeah. God, I want patience and I want it now. Like that? Okay. Yeah, patience. We need patience and wait in God's presence. Then, what else shall we pray? We have to wait now. What to do? What to pray? Okay, pray continually till we receive it. Say Saubhagya. Okay, so how about we just summarize these prayers as prayers of faith. So prayers of thanksgiving, Lord, prepare me, and I'm expecting this, and I'm so joyful. These are all prayers of faith where we are confident it's going to happen. So just keep praying prayers of faith and standing in faith till we see the manifestation of what God has already given us, you know, in our spirit. So that's how one must continue. Now, what about prayers such as, God, that guitar, give me, please, 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 I'm begging you, don't forget. What about prayers like that? Huh? Keep reminding, God will forget. Yeah, so actually we don't have to pray like that, because he already knows, he's already granted it to us. So when we say perseverance in prayer, there are passages, we'll come to it when we study about perseverance, in Luke 11 verse 5 and 8, Luke 18 verse 1 and 8, we see that, you know, there is a widow who goes to a judge, and she starts pestering him. Every day she goes and says, I want justice, I want justice, I want justice. He gets irritated. He's like, okay, take your justice, take it and go. You know, he comes to that point. But God, Jesus used that analogy to help us understand that if a judge, a wicked judge, can respond because someone is so consistent, how much more our loving Heavenly Father will respond to us. And another example there in those passages is when a friend goes late in the night begging for food. Even though it's quite frustrating to get up and come and help him, because of the continual begging, the friend says, okay, fine, just take it. Okay, so what Jesus was trying to say is when we persevere, we continue asking, even the people of the world give it. So if there is something which is in the will of God, why should you stop? Don't stop. Ask the Father, and it doesn't mean that the Father is going to take so much of time that we repeatedly ask Him. That's not needed. God is willing. God will give you. You persevere, be consistent. So that's what he was trying to say. But being consistent, persevering does not mean begging or even like, you know, again and again reminding God, not required. Yeah, if we do that, nothing wrong, but we don't need to do that. We must continue with prayers of faith, which say, thank you, God. You've already done it for me. Thank you. You're already preparing me. Thank you. It's going to be so wonderful. You know, if I can walk in the promise that you have for my life. So these are the prayers of faith that we will continue in till we receive our answer. And of course, the book of Hebrews says, hold fast to your confession, the confession of your faith. So we must never change our confession. Even when we pray, we must affirm and say, God, you've done it for me. Now think about Abraham. Though he believed, the people around him must have reminded him, you don't have a son, Abraham. And at that time, he never changed his confession. He never said, yeah, I don't have. No. Hold fast to your confession. My God has promised, he will do it for me. That is another thing. Continue in prayers of faith and continue with the confession that God will do it. God will do it. Okay. So we don't have to go and irritate others with our confession. Like Joseph, you know, I'm going to be greater than all of you. Because he spoke like that without wisdom, his brothers became jealous and they sold him. So we don't have to go and tell everybody what God's promise is for our lives. It's in your heart, it's fine. You confess it. Confess it every time and hold on to it. And surely the Lord will do it for us. So continue with prayers of faith and thanksgiving. So thanksgiving is included in the point 7 over here. Now, there are certain common questions which we will address. But before the questions in the book, do we have any questions about asking and receiving from the Lord?
I would like to ask Julia. A question concerning the Holy Spirit. As we were starting, you talked about how the pattern that the Lord Jesus showed us of praying through him to the Father. Then you mentioned we could pray to the Holy Spirit. I just wanted
to... Juliana, sorry to interrupt you. I don't think I'm able to hear you very clearly.
Oh, I'll take the question. Can you hear me now?
Sorry?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Please go ahead. Please go ahead. I'll try to understand your question.
Okay. I'm referring to a bit earlier when you started off and you are saying the pattern Jesus laid for us of praying through him to mm-hmm. the Father.
Yes.
In his name to the Father. Then you mentioned something about praying to the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And I just wanted a clarification on that because I know there's a lot of contention of whether we can pray to the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Maybe you could just shed some light on that.
Yeah, sure. So Juliana is asking, we had mentioned about it's okay to pray to the Father, and if we pray a prayer to Jesus and the Holy Spirit also. Okay, so she's asking clarity about that. I'll just quickly turn to one verse. Yes, so this verse is from 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 14, which we usually use as the benediction in many, many places. And we say, may the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. What is communion? You know, when we look at that word in the Greek, that's the word koinonia. And koinonia means fellowship and partnership. Now, how can we have fellowship and partnership if we don't speak? We can't. If you're having fellowship with our church members, it's because we're talking to them and we're saying, brother, how are you doing? You know, what are you doing? Can I please... can you help me like this? We're asking them, right? What is prayer? Prayer, we've said already, it's conversation with God. Yes, one aspect of prayer is also asking from God. So the scripture clearly says that you and I, we are supposed to have fellowship and partnership with the Holy Spirit. So Juliana, that itself is prayer. Right there for us. Does that help?
Yes, it does. Thank you very much.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Yes. Yes. Any other questions, clarifications? About receiving from the Lord. Yes, yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For example,
okay. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah. So what is the question?
The question is, should the person work towards getting to know that person, going to that person?
Complicated.
Or if it's your will, you may
have. Yeah. So what Vinay is saying is, in the context of finding a life partner, if let's say a person thinks that, X, Y, or Z is the person for them, then what should they do? Whether they should work towards it or not, right? So I would go back to point number 3 here, Vinay, where we said, determine whether it is God's will, first of all. So without determining whether it is God's will, if you work on it, then you are setting yourself up to maybe fail. Yeah. And then God is not responsible. We can't say that I prayed so much, I prayed for 2 years, God never answered. But was it God's will in the first place? Now, if it is God's will, then I think it's a matter of wisdom and patience, right? So you keep it in prayer, you speak to godly elders, and you ask them, what are we supposed to do? You know, am I supposed to continue praying and waiting, or is there some action or step that I need to take? And hopefully, the Bible says there is safety in the the counsel of many. And so hopefully we will have a wise advice given to you on whether you need to act in your faith or not. But again, you know, having said this, in matters of marriage, or let's say even business decisions, it involves another person's will. So whether that person will say yes or no depends on them. We can't predict that. And it will be their will, whatever they say. Yeah? Okay, great. Yes. All right. Yes. Any other questions? Now, even if it is God's will and if the other person says no, the prayer is still, technically you may say, oh, it wasn't successful. But yeah, what to do? Another person's will is involved. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, so let's come to our common questions then. One question here states, if I have prayed and asked once for something, is it correct if I keep asking God for the same thing again and again and again? What do you feel? Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Definitely. Yes. Yes. Yeah. So when I'm saying the attitude matters, the conscience with which the person has approached God with this request matters. And if there is a prayer which needs continual asking, there are many such prayers, like one you pointed out with regard to salvation. So when we pray for people's salvation, sometimes we have to keep praying. Though we believe that God is working in their lives, we have to keep praying. We can't stop. When we ask God for healing, sometimes we have to keep praying. So nothing wrong if you're asking again and again. When we pray for revival, we have to keep praying. When we pray for spiritual growth and development, we have to keep praying. These are prayers that must be prayed continuously. So that's okay if it falls in that category. If it falls in the category of asking and receiving, as long as we've done all of the above, and if we are convinced, we've prayed in faith, then we don't have to ask again and again. Right? But if we have not come to that level where in our spirit we are clear that yes, God has already done it, then one may end up asking again and again, right? Which actually may not be required. We must come to a place of faith and then move on with an attitude of faith and thanksgiving. So that's the right way. Yeah, sure. So let's look at another question here. Does God always give whatever we ask? So we know the answer to this question. As long as our prayer is aligned to the word of God, aligned to the laws, spiritual laws and natural laws, God will answer. But then there are only some times that God may override these laws. For example, you know, the bread being multiplied. Jesus did it. We read about it. You know, he fed like 5,000 men and all. But do you read every day? Like, okay, you know, Peter Bakery, John Bakery, every day. Let's multiply bread. Let's sell it, guys, you know. And let's have lots of bread. Let's get into the bread business. He doesn't do that. Why? Because there's a natural law. What is that? The miracle happened only to meet a need on that day. But regularly, what was the norm? They were cooking. They were providing for themselves. They were planning. And they were managing their day-to-day activities. So, the point is, you know, we may ask God, God, you said whatever things you ask for in prayer, believe you will receive. But there is a natural law. Every day I can't expect, God, I will walk on water. You know, today water will turn into wine. So it doesn't work like that, the whatever. Only if there is a need, special need, God will do the miracle. But otherwise, natural laws. You know, Philip was transported from the road to Gaza. He was transported to his next ministry destination. Every day morning, 8 o'clock, I can't say, oh, Jesus, take me to Bible college. Transport. I disappeared from my house and I reached Bible college. It won't happen like that. There are natural laws. You have to go by the natural. Sometimes God will make an exception with these miracles. So whatever doesn't mean whatever like that. Okay, so great. We've understood that as well. What if I do not know God's will about a matter? Now what to do? We've done all our praying, fasting, asking. I still don't know if it is God's will. What to do now? Surrender. Okay, that is the correct answer. Okay. Just surrender to God. Now, if we have done our part to know God's will and we are not able to understand it for whatever reason, just say, God, like how Jesus prayed, Lord, let this cup pass away from me, but not my will, yours be done. I don't know if it is the right thing for me to choose this career, but the door is open. I'm going anyway. Not my will, yours be done. If this is not for me, you show me God, you help me God, just surrender. So that's how it is. If we don't know the will of God, after having tried, surrender is the best position. And you just pray a prayer of consecration. You say, Lord, you know I love you. You know I'm living for you. I want to do your will. I am just going to move. You help me now. You guide me and position me according to your purposes. I'm surrendering my heart. I'm surrendering my life. I'm surrendering everything. So a prayer of surrender, consecration is the prayer that one must pray when we are not clear if something is God's will. Okay. Yes. Any questions? Yeah. Same. Huh? Okay. Yeah. Can prayer change God's mind? Okay. All right. Yeah. So, we can consider two examples. One is from Genesis 18. Genesis 18, when God tells Abraham what he's going to do. So he reveals to him that he's going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Then what happens? Abraham starts negotiating with God. He says, God, no, don't do it. If there are so many righteous people, will you spare the land? God says, okay. And then the discussion goes on. If there are so many righteous. But unfortunately, there were no righteous people God had to destroy. But what do we see? God is listening to a man. Can you imagine? God should have just directly gone and destroyed. But what is he doing? Abraham is saying, no. Please consider. If there are so many, will you? God is actually, you could say, changing his mind. But I say that with, very carefully, changing his mind in the sense, if it is in the nature of God and within what he has, whatever he has permitted, it can be accommodated. Because in this case, what is Abraham asking for? Grace, mercy. It is there in God's nature. That's why God was listening to him. Think about Jonah. Jonah is the prophet of doom and destruction to Nineveh. He goes to Nineveh. Hesitantly, he goes, a fish transports him to Nineveh. Here is Jonah. He's preaching, repent. Otherwise, judgment is coming. And what happens? The people pray. What did God say? Judgment. What did God do? No judgment. Why? The people prayed. Change of decision. So it is possible as long as it is in the nature of God. Because they were praying for mercy and forgiveness, which is in the nature of God. So only if it is in the nature of God, you can say God will change his mind. But if it's not, then we can't expect it. Okay. Yes, Biplav? Yeah, okay. Which one? Okay, Deuteronomy 32. Okay, verse 4. Yes, yeah. So, God always does good and he looks to do good. And that's the reason he accommodated the prayer requests. There's a question. 1 second, Prem. I'll just come back to you. Ask. You can ask. Ask, please. Yeah, Prem.
So, how he knows everything. If I'm asking for a player to change his mind, you also know that. And how is it possible?
Yeah, see, there is something about we human beings engaging with our free will. And God will never control. We can say the same thing about Genesis 3. Why did God create the world when he knew that Adam and Eve are going to sin? But what is the point? The point is, he has given us what is known as free will. So even though he knows what we are going to do, he still chooses to give us an opportunity. That's how it is. Yeah. So does that answer your question? Yeah. Any other questions, points for discussion?
Pastor, can I quote one instance?
Yes, please, John.
See, Isaiah 38, when I was reading this chapter, Ezekiel falls ill. And the Lord says, this is what the Lord says, put your house in order because you are going to die. You will never not recover.
Okay.
So Ezekiel turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord.
Yes.
Remember, O Lord, and all that. And he weeps bitterly. So then God extends his life for another 15 years.
15 years, right.
So God can reverse, whatever. I think this fits into that context.
Sure. Yeah, that's another example of how there was something that was going to happen, but because a man prayed, the decision was changed. So Hezekiah's life was extended by 15 years, and that's the example that John is mentioning. So thank you, John. Thanks for sharing. Here on the chat, Pooja asks a question. She says, those who didn't take baptism, can they take communion? those who didn't take baptism. So those who are born again can take the communion, because the communion is for those who belong to the body of Christ. So let's say a believer is born again but not yet water baptized, they can take communion. Okay, so that is one. Now, she's also written unbelievers. Unbelievers should not take communion because they don't belong to the body of Christ. Is that okay, Pooja? Please let me know if you have any further questions.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you so much.
Yeah, sure.
Pastor, some believers, they didn't took baptism, but they are taking the communion also, just so I ask you.
Okay. So, some believers, could you please come again?
Yeah, they come for church, but they didn't took the baptism.
Mm-hmm.
Then they're taking the breaking of bread also. Communion.
Yeah, sure. Yes. So, see, in order to participate in the Lord's table, one should have salvation. And baptism is not a determinant for salvation. We are water baptized because we are born again. It's a proclamation of our faith. So once people are born again, like if you go to Acts chapter 2, Peter preaches a message and 3,000 people respond. Once they receive Christ, he tells them, you can be baptized. They baptize them on the same day. So baptism comes after one is born again. So it's not like, you know, if somebody is not water baptized, they are not born again. So because they are born again, they can participate in the Holy Communion. Because they are born again, they are the body of Christ, they can participate in the Holy Communion. And they should also be taught to be baptized in water. That's the correct way. Is that okay, Pooja?
Yes, yeah. Pastor. Thank you so much.
I didn't give you scripture and verse and all, but I would suggest that you can go to our resources section on the website. It's apcwo.org/books. Go to the books. There is a book on water baptism. There is a book on the house of God, which has an entire chapter on the Holy Communion. So you have a lot of scriptures there, and whatever I shared is based on those scriptures. So that'll give us a better grip, right? Always when we have scriptures, we have a better grip. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. Any other questions? We have only 5 minutes, so I thought I'll start the next chapter, but I will not. So we can devote it to questions. Okay, have we ever prayed a prayer and believed God very hard and it was not answered? Okay, so then what went wrong? Because we saw the steps today. We saw how we should pray a believing prayer. What could have gone wrong in our personal experience? Okay, so, huh? Yeah. Sure. So, yeah, based on the steps that we discussed, there could be an issue with any one of those. So maybe it was not God's will. Maybe we didn't ask with a clear conscience, or, you know, many other things could have gone wrong. So we can evaluate our own situations. And I'm not saying that we will find an answer to all our questions, but hopefully somewhat we might find an answer. Okay, so with that, let's stop for today. And again, online batch, requesting one of us to please unmute and pray aloud.
Father God, we want to thank you for the lessons that we have had. We want to thank you, dear Lord, that we can share your word and receive it in our spirit. We thank you, Father, that even when we had a connectivity problem, you did come through. We pray your blessing over our teacher, Pastor Nancy, and over each one of us. Even as we break for today, bless us and be with us. Thank you once again, Lord, that you have opened this door for us, that we can come to you in prayer and commune with you. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Mubai. And thank you so much, everyone, for connecting to today's class.